Darden Show, where we look at everything Darden, from apples to zinnias and trees to turf. And we are live and interactive. You can call in and ask us questions about your garden or questions about anything in your landscape, whether it be pests, something you'd like to grow, something you're growing that's not doing well. Our number is 1-800-339-1193. My name is Jerry Turney, or Gerald Turney. I grew up being called Jerry, but technically my name is Gerald. I'm a senior biologist with the Los Angeles County Department of Agriculture. I'm a plant pathologist, certified arborist, and licensed pest control officer with the state of California. So if you have any questions about your landscape, I probably can answer them. If I can't, I can look into it and direct you to where you might get the answer. Now, we always like to start our show with upcoming events. So you can put these on your calendar and not miss some of the fun stuff that you can do out in Southern California. It's a beautiful day today, and it's a beautiful weekend. It'll probably be that way for many, many years. It seems to be we are endless sunshine in Southern California, although we did get some rain this week. Let's look at our calendar and see what we can see if there's something you'd like to do. The Haunted Tours of the Garden will be at the Fullerton Arboretum on October 23rd and 24th. You can call 657-278-3407 for more information. That should be a lot of fun. Take the kids and have a little Halloween event down at the Fullerton Arboretum. In addition to that, we have some volunteering opportunities, which would be a lot of fun if you want to get out and help out with some of these groups. There's the tree people, which have their million trees. They want to plant a million trees, so they're going to be planting at LA Park Planting in Sylmar on October 24th from 9 a.m. to 12 a.m. And if you want to help out with that planting, you can call 818-623-4879 and let them know you want to come. They can always use an extra pair of hands, whether you're just going to help shovel in a little dirt or carry a tree around. The Tree People is a great group, and they're planting trees throughout Southern California. They also have a mountain restoration program. And that, on October 24th, again from 9 to 12 a.m. in Calabasas, they'll be doing mountain restoration. And you call the same number again for more information and to let them know you want to volunteer and help out with this. They also have a community tree planting in Long Beach. This is part of trying to plant a million trees. That's October 25th from 9 a.m. 12 a.m. Again, call 818-623-4879 to let them know you want to come and get any additional information. At the Manhattan Beach Botanical Garden, on November 7th, they have Creating Wildlife Habitat with Natives. This is a free class. You do need to call and get a reservation. It is free, and they always have a really excellent instructor to talk about using natives in your yard. That's November 7th, 10 to 11 a.m. Call 310-546-1354 for more information and let them know you're coming because they have limited space. It is free, but you need to make a reservation. In addition to that, we may have another calendar item. Tree trimming guidelines will also be a class at the Manhattan Beach Botanical Garden on November 14th from 10 a.m. to 11 a.m. So they always get a good arborist down there who will give you some of the basics on tree pruning. We've covered it on this show several times. Again, call 310-546-1354. Let them know you're coming. It is free. The Orchid Festival at the San Diego Botanical Gardens, which previously was Quail Gardens. They have changed their name to the San Diego Botanical Gardens. They're on Quail Gardens Drive in Encinitas, November 21st from 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. This is an orchid festival. You'll be able to see many, many species of orchids and purchase orchids. Their number is 760-436-3036. And that should be a lot of fun. Manhattan Beach Botanical Garden again on November 21st. Success with succulents. This is how to use succulents in your landscape or grow them in pots. That's 10 to 11 a.m. This is another one of their free classes. Call a lot of them are coming. 310-546-1354. So put those down on your calendar and enjoy the great outdoors in Southern California. Now, today, I want to talk about a couple of things, but mostly we're going to talk about mushrooms today. I want to talk about how you identify mushrooms, which mushrooms you can expect to see in your garden, and what they need in your garden. And just briefly, I want to talk about the rain we had last week. That was a pretty good drizzle we had, very unusual for this early in October. But what it really means is you can turn off your sprinkler system for at least a week. When we get that kind of good rain, the soil is soaked to a depth of probably at least 12 inches, so lawns won't need any irrigation for about a week. Even though we got hot, you can turn off your sprinkler system for about 7 days. And next weekend, we're going to talk more in depth about irrigating your landscape and how you irrigate your landscape. But in addition, that rain is going to stimulate a lot of mushrooms to pop up. And I immediately saw mushrooms coming up in lawns all over the place. So I was motivated to talk about mushrooms today. I want to remind you we're live and on the air, and you can call in with any questions you've got. Our number is 1-800-339-1193. Now, mushrooms are a lot of fun. Some people kind of panic when they see them coming up their lawns. They might think that that really means you've got a pathogen or some terrible problem in your lawn. But in general, that's not true. There's only a few mushrooms that actually are pathogenic and cause disease on plants. Most notably, the oak rootrot fungus, Armillaria bellia, and the jack-o'-lantern mushroom, Ophiolotus olivescens. Both of those grow on trees and cause a root rot and a collar rot right down at the base of the tree. And they can kill trees. The oak root rot fungus, Armillaria, is fairly common throughout Southern California, especially in any area that was an oak woodland. The jack-o'-lantern mushroom, Ophiolotus, is a little more rare. I've only seen it a couple times. I saw it in Estanza Gardens one time on a dead stump, and I saw it out at Rancho Santa Ana on a living tree fruiting off the base of it, indicating that tree was infected. But let's talk a little more in general about fungi and what are fungi and the various kinds of fungi. And behind me, you can see Armillaria bellia, the oak root rot fungus. And I'll talk about that more in depth in a moment. But thanks. Now, the kingdom fungi. Historically, fungi, a long time ago, were thought to be saprophytic or parasitic plants. But indeed, they are not plants at all. They are not particularly related to plants. They're actually more related to animals than they are plants. But they have an intrinsic relationship with plants. In many, many aspects of plant biology or botany, fungi play a key and important role. Now, what are some of the common fungi? They include the yeasts. Yeasts are actually fungi. Molds, we see mold all the time. You can see it in your bathroom, in your shower. You can see it in your refrigerator growing on old strawberries, not very old, only about 5 minutes after you put it in there. Of course, mushrooms are fungi. And then there's a group that are called polypores. Those are usually the shelf fungi that grow off the sides of trees. And you break one of those off and flip it over. You'll see that it doesn't have gills like a mushroom. It has very small, minute pores. There are also the boletes, which are soft, fleshy mushrooms, but have pores as well. There are stinkhorns. Stinkhorns often are kilometer with a mass on the top that is a stinking mass of spores that attract flies. There are puffballs, which are kind of self-descriptive. They're usually spherical with a pore, and if you push on them, they puff spores into the air. Many puffballs, though, do not have a pore. They just break apart slowly. In addition, there are jelly fungi, which I won't go into much today, and I'm not going to really talk about them too much. And then the rusts, like rose rust, that's a fungus. And the smuts, there's corn smut, and there's various smuts that affect a variety of plants. Those are both, rusts and smuts are pathogens. And then, of course, there are truffles. So truffles are mushrooms or fungi that fruit underground, usually growing in association with tree roots. and they're usually what we call mycorrhizal. Mycorrhizal means fungus root or growing in association with roots. And that's a select group of fungi. There are quite a few actually that do that. And many of them fruit underground, although many of them fruit on the surface forming mushrooms. So it all depends on your species you're talking about. But the truffles are all mycorrhizal. And many of the really colorful flamboyant mushrooms that you see in the forest are also mycorrhizal. So what makes a fungus? Fungi grow by filaments. If you were to look at that mold that grows on a strawberry in your refrigerator under a microscope, you see that gray fluffy stuff is a whole bunch of microscopic filaments or tubes. And in mass, we call that a mycelium. And fungi have cell walls, like plants have cell walls, but their cell walls are not made with cellulose or wood. They're made with chitin. Chitin is the same material that insects use to construct their ectoskeleton, their outside of the insect body, which is an exterior skeleton. So you can see that, you know, having chitin as the major cell wall constituent, that actually means, indicates that they're more related to animals than they are to plants. Plants have cellulose as their cell wall constituent. Now, most fungi play a key role in the decomposition of organic matter in the soil and in mulch piles or wherever things are rotting and decaying. It's primarily fungi that are accomplishing that. Other things also decompose organic matter. Nematodes gobble up stuff in soil and mulch piles, but fungi are the major decomposers of organic matter. Now, there are two broad groups of what we call fleshy fungi, or large fruity bodies. There are the club fungi, and so-called because they produce their spores on a club on the surface of usually the gill of the mushroom. Mushrooms are club fungi. In fact, most of the large fleshy fungi you'll see fruiting either in the woods or on your front lawn or somewhere in your yard, most of those are what we call club fungi. And so that's mushrooms and the bullies and the shelf fungi. The coral fungi, we'll show you some of those. Those are called club fungi, so that's a big group. And then the second big group are the sac fungi. The sac fungi make their spores inside of a sac, in a microscopic sac. And most of the sac fungi, you don't see them for, they make microscopic fruiting structures or just pinhead-sized fruiting structures, and you don't notice them producing their spores. They don't have a large, fleshy structure that produces spores. But some of them do, and some of them are quite well known, and actually some of the best edible mushrooms that you can collect are in fact sac fungi. That would include the morels and also what we call the cup fungi. A morel is one of the cup fungi. So if we can start, what are the most important characteristics for identifying mushrooms? Well, when you identify a mushroom, you need to use what we call a key. And a key is a book that allows you to look at the characteristics of the mushroom and go through a set of questions and hopefully at the end arrive at the species or at least a good idea of which species it probably is. Now, one of the most important things you can do, really, if you want to go out and collect mushrooms, is to go on some mushroom forays with people who have experience. And locally, that would be with the Los Angeles Mycological Society, LAMS for short. And they organize forays up into the mountains, into the Cleveland National Forest, in the Santa Monica Mountains, and various locations throughout Southern California. And go with them and see what you can see out there. When you get your collections, then everyone gets together, and they'll usually have someone who leads the mushroom foray. And that person will have a lot of experience and will be able to identify the various mushrooms. It's not uncommon to find things you can't identify or that are new to you. So when you're out there actually looking for edibles, remember, most of the stuff you're going to find is probably not going to be edible, and a lot of stuff is not going to be identifiable, which by definition means you're not going to eat. So you have to educate yourself before you really start looking for edibles. Now, before we go on much more about the characteristics, this is one of the best books you can get, especially for beginners. It's Mushrooms Demystified by David Arora. And it's a wonderful book. We put it here and you get it on the overhead so you can see the cover. This is a very vernacular writing of key for mushrooms. He doesn't use a lot of technical terms. He tries to stay away from the technical terms, and he's very lighthearted, and he has a lot of witty things to say about collecting mushrooms. But he covers all the mushrooms you can find, all the fungi you can find out in the woods. He lives in the Santa Cruz area, I believe in the Santa Cruz Mountains, and so this book is particularly good for the Central California coast and for California. If you're collecting other parts of the United States or North America, this isn't the best book because it's really oriented more towards the Western United States. But it's really a wonderful book and the first book you should get if you start collecting mushrooms and you want to have a key. Some of the other keys that are out there are not like keys. They're more like picture books, and they're difficult to come to a conclusion as to what you're dealing with unless you're kind of lucky. You get a distinct mushroom. It's not that difficult to recognize, like a morel or like the oyster mushroom. And we'll look at those in a moment. But let's talk about characteristics. What are the central characteristics that we use to identify mushrooms? The first couplet in a key. Now, keys work usually with two questions, and it's called a couplet. So it'll say, in mushrooms, the first couplet is almost always what we call the spore print color. Now, in order to know that, you've got to cut the cap off your mushroom and put it on a piece of paper and cover it up with a bowl or a glass to prevent the wind from blowing underneath it. And when you do that, the spores that are being produced on the gill surface of the mushroom, on the gills themselves, are shooting off and dropping down onto the paper. And after about an hour or up to even more, sometimes maybe a whole day, you'll get an accumulation of these spores on the paper. And that's a spore print. And it can be almost any color. It can be white to almost black. It can be green. It can be pink. It can be rusty brown. It's almost any color you can think of, like purple black. And because mushrooms are coming up all over the place over the last few days, I was able to run out and collect a bunch of mushrooms and cut some caps off and make a spore print. Now let's go to the overhead camera again, and we'll take a look at the spore prints that I made yesterday. Here is a spore print, and the spore print color here is what we would call a dark brown or chocolate brown. And here's a cap. This is a mushroom I actually collected today, this morning, from a lawn next door to my home. And what you do is you set the mushroom right here on the paper, like that, and then you cover it up with a bowl, or sometimes I just use a bowl like that, and I'm going to let it sit there, maybe for about an hour, and take a look. Now this one I made, this is about an hour, this one was much thicker, this one actually sat overnight, so you see it's thicker, but it unfortunately got rubbed off, a lot got rubbed off, but you can see, if we can we get a little closer and take a closer look at these spore prints? Is it possible to zoom in on that? Because you can see actually the lines here. See all these lines? Those correspond with the gills in the mushroom cap. So spore prints are fun. It's kind of a fun thing you might do with your kids. Make a spore print, they go to different colors. And so that's the first thing you have to do to identify your mushroom. You have to make a spore print. Very young mushrooms that are in the button stage, and you haven't expanded yet, the gills are probably not mature, and you're not going to get a spore print. So when you're collecting mushrooms, you really need to get young mushrooms, middle-aged or mature mushrooms, and then old mushrooms. So you can get a look at all the way the mushroom changes over time, because the characteristics will change over time. So in addition to the spore print, a lot of other characteristics that are important in the identification of mushrooms. Like to remind you, we're live and on the air, and you can call in with your questions at 1-800-339-1193. So the other characteristics, in addition to the spore print, are the actual, whether the mushroom has gills or whether it has pores under the cap, on the bottom surface of the cap. Now let's take a look at picture number one. which we saw just briefly a moment ago. This is our malaria amelia. And you can see when you look at this that this mushroom actually has gills. It doesn't have pores. And if we take a look at photograph number 13, we'll see what are referred to as bolete. Now, if you look at this, and you can't see it real good, but the undersurface there, those aren't gills. Those are actually pores. Now, the boletes are a big group, and they come in a lot of different species, but they're soft and fleshy, like the gill mushrooms, but this is a pore surface. In addition to that, we can take a look at picture number 15. There are the shelf fungi. Let's bring that up. This is kind of a fun picture. This is the undersurface of one of the shelf fungi growing on the side of a tree. It's Ganoderma applanatum is the species, but the common name is the artist conch, because you can draw on this poroid surface, and it stays brown when you draw on it, and if you let it dry, you can actually create a drawing, some people, lumberjacks have been known to break these off in the forest, and write messages on them, and then leave them in the road for their colleagues to see later, telling them where they went to lunch, or something like that, or directing them to a location. But you can see that's an example of a conch with a poroid surface instead of gills. So that's often one of the early couplets is whether your mushroom has gills or pores, whether it's hard and firm or whether it's soft and fleshy. The other thing is whether the mushroom has a ring on the stem. And that stem is often referred to as a stipe, but stipe or stem is the same thing. It can be present or absent, and it can be, if it's present, it can be like a skirt hanging way down, or it can be just a little tiny weft, almost like a spider's web. So if we'll take a look, go back to picture number one again, and this is our malaria amelia, and you can see that it has a distinct ring at the top of the stem, just below the gills. So in this case, it's present. And if we look at picture number six, this is the bluet or Lepisa nuda, and it does not have a ring. So in this case, it's absent. Ooh. So you can see right here, there is no ring. So in this case, it's absent. And in addition to that ring, now that ring is left by what we call the partial veil. There are two veils that can be present on a mushroom. The universal veil envelops the entire mushroom. The partial veil just covers the gills and then hangs down on the stem after the mushroom expands. So if you've got a ring, that means you had a partial veil. The universal veil covers the whole mushroom before it opens. And often, those types of mushrooms have an egg. They start off like an egg. They pop up, and it leaves a sac-like at the base of the mushroom. It's sac-like. It's like a sac there. We can take a look at photo number two real quick. And let's expand that. And we'll take a look at that. And you can see here at the base, right here, this is a sac-like veil. It's the remnants of the universal veil. And it's called a vulva. And it's really important when you collect your mushrooms, so you collect the entire mushroom, that you use a trowel or some type of hard implement to stick down in the soil and pop the whole mushroom. Because if you miss that vulva, then you're gonna misidentify your mushroom. This particular mushroom is Ammonida phalloides, the destroying angel. It's a deadly mushroom. Ammonidas are deadly mushrooms. I see we have a phone call, so let's go to our first caller. Thor, calling from Canoga Park. You're on the air.
Yes, hello.
Hello.
Yes, I was calling. I'm from Colorado. I'm used to the mushrooms up in that area, and I'm in my yard, Canoga Park, after the rain, and some mushrooms pop up, and I'm doing the roots underneath, you know, the scales. And so I took the chance to put one in and survive, but I just want to make sure for future, you know, what I should be aware of.
Well, you know, the ones that are coming up right now in lawns, almost all of them are going to be in the genus Agaricus. Now, Agaricus is a pretty big genus with a lot of species. There's a couple that will get you sick to your stomach, and there's two types of mushroom poisoning. There's the really serious liver poisoning that you get from the Amanitas, you know, the destroying angels, and you hear about that. People need a liver transplant. Then there's the gastrointestinal poisoning, where you get sick to your stomach, and you might get diarrhea or throw up. And that's what the agarics would do to you. If you ate one of those and you got sick to your stomach, it usually happens within about 30 minutes of eating the mushroom too. If you eat one of the really deadly ones, you won't get sick for about 24 hours typically. So,
well, I guess I'm pretty lucky with that. I just want to make sure I know it's been postal, so after reviewing much of the roots underneath quite a bit of different diseases.
Well, the only way to be sure you're not eating a poisonous mushroom is to identify it to species and know whether that species is edible. So, there, you know, there's a few key characteristics of the agarics that'll tell you not to eat it. When they come up on your lawn, and that's what I actually showed, this spore print that I just showed, that chocolate brown spore print, and it's a large white mushroom that comes up on a lawn, typically after a good rainstorm. If you scratch the cap or scratch the stem and it stains yellow, then that's going to be one of the yellow-staining agarics. And the most common one we have is Agaricus xanthonervus. That'll make you sick to your stomach. So you shouldn't eat it if you scratch it and it stains yellow and it's got those chocolate brown spore print. Because it's almost...
You scratch the top of it, you say it.
Either scratch the cap or the stem or cut through the base, it will stain bright yellow almost instantly.
Okay.
Very quickly. Now, if you cut through the whole mushroom, and the cap, inside the tissue in the cap stains like a wine red or a burgundy red, that's probably Agaricus bernardia, and that's an excellent edible. So, it's, you know, I don't know which one you ate. Now, and then there's also a couple others. There's Agaricus bitorcus, but that typically fruits underground, and when it comes up, it pushes up the soil with it. And then there's Agaricus californicus, which has an inrolled margin, and it doesn't stain yellow. And I've heard that one will make you sick to your stomach, too. I haven't tried that one. I've eaten Agaricus bernardii and bitorcus. I've not eaten xanthodermis because I've been told, and it's written in all the books, that that'll make you sick to your stomach. So if you didn't get sick, you most likely ate either, probably bernardii. And you're
in. Under the cap, too. It's not like a perfectly round hooded cap. You cut it and it's around, like it goes down and has different, you know, pipes on the top. But I actually put one in my hand.
Well, I would caution you not to eat mushrooms out of your lawn unless you've identified them well. And if you get this book I mentioned, which is Mushrooms Demystified, and it's worth about $40, I think it's a wise investment. And go in there and read about the agarics. He's got an excellent introduction to each genus. And so, and he tells you how you can differentiate between the other genera and the species you're going to find out in your garden. You have to be careful to scratch them. If they stain yellow, absolutely don't eat them. Okay?
Well, I appreciate the advice. You've got to be real cautious. Obviously, you don't want to have a professional experiment on these things.
Yeah, and you got to be careful. You took a little risk there, and you got lucky.
Yeah, I appreciate that.
Okay, good luck with your car. I see we have another caller. Let's go to our next caller. Terry from South Pasadena, you're on the air.
Yes, my mom lives about the Rose Bowl, and she has some orange-colored hair-like growth. It's on some of her shrubs, on the native plants on the slope above her house. What is that orange growth, and how do you control it?
Okay, that's a really interesting question. I've had a number of people call into the lab all the time asking about that. That's called dar. It's a native plant. It's a parasitic plant. And it grows, it'll germinate from the seed, and then it grows up onto the plant, and then after it gets attached to the plant, it starts feeding off the plant.
it will lose its attachment to the soil. It's a flowering plant, so it will flower and make more seeds, and those will drop down to the ground. And then when it rains, they'll germinate and continue that. It's very common in the chaparral, and if you drive, I see it all the time. When I'm driving along the 134 above Eagle Rock, and you can see it all over the chaparral there. It turns out it's very, very sensitive to nitrogen fertilizer. And so if you just use a liquid fertilizer, but a lawn fertilizer, a little high in nitrogen, probably at least 15% nitrogen, and use it first at the label rate and spray it on the plants and on the daughter, typically it'll burn the daughter right off of them, and it won't hurt the plants at all. Now you need to be careful and test it, because high nitrogen on some plants can burn them as well. So if you spray just a few plants first, wait a day or two to see if that was enough to burn off the daughter, and a little less than what it takes to burn the plants. That's always the goal of any attempt to control pests. You want to use something that kills the pest but doesn't kill the host. And I had someone recently who emailed me back and said that she just used lawn fertilizer, a liquid lawn fertilizer that she sprayed on at label rate, and she got a little bit of burning on the shrubs, not very much at all, but it burned all the daughter off within a couple days.
Okay, well, thank you. And I have one other question.
Okay.
My mother has these mushrooms in her lawn in her front of her house.
They just came up this week?
Yeah.
Okay, what I've seen coming up right now are the agaricus, species within agaricus. Now, agaricus, the ones you buy in the market, the button mushrooms are agaricus bisporus. The one also, the portobello is also agaricus bisporus. It's just a mature one. Because they used to always just ship the button mushrooms because they were heavier and firmer and easier to ship. And then people realized, you know, people started wanting more than just button mushrooms. So now you can find a lot of different mushrooms available in the market. So they're probably agaricus. And if you stay tuned, then we'll cover all the characteristics you need to look at to identify them. They are saprophytic. They're not causing a disease in the lawn. They're just growing in the soil and decomposing organic matter in the soil. There's no way to really get rid of them, and there's no need to treat the lawn with anything. A lot of people call up and say, oh, I've got mushrooms in my lawn. How do I get rid of them? If you're concerned about either a dog eating them or that they might be one of the ones that make you sick in your stomach, you can just collect them all and throw them in the trash or throw them in your mulch pile. You've got a mulch pile. But they don't really represent a hazard to your garden. Those are common saprophytic mushrooms or fungi that come up typically after our first good rain in the fall, and they will fruit almost year-round. There's a variety of species. Okay, so don't worry about those mushrooms. Those are the good guys.
Okay, well, thank you for your information.
Oh, thank you.
Enjoy your show.
Thank you for calling, and good luck with your garden.
Thank you.
I see we have another caller, so let's go to our next caller. Maria, calling from Los Angeles. You're on the air.
Question. I have a pomegranate tree that before they come to full ripe, they open up. And that's my question. Why?
They split. How often do you water the tree?
A lot of water.
Okay, they don't need a lot of water. Usually fruit split is due to overwatering. And it usually happens in the fall. And what happens is, you know, it could be in citrus or it could be in pomegranate or a variety of fruits. The rind matures, and then the tree takes up a lot more water, and the rind is no longer flexible and can't expand. And then it splits. So now pomegranates are pretty drought tolerant. How often do you water it?
As I said, a lot of water. I put a lot of water.
Well, do you water it every day or what?
Yeah, almost every time every day.
Okay, you're watering way too much.
Okay. So how many times a week?
It's not times a week, it's times a month.
I'm so old.
You want to water it probably, Where are you in L.A.? Are you,
Right in Los Angeles, right in the center of Los Angeles.
I would want to...
In the area of Alhambra.
Oh, okay. Well, you're kind of on the, you're on the El Cerrito area, perhaps.
Exactly.
Okay. I know the San Diego Valley well. I grew up there.
Okay.
I would water it at the most once a week in the summer, and I would water it twice a month in the spring and fall.
Oh, okay.
And you want to water it for about an hour or two with a very slow application, with like a soaker hose, so that it soaks deep into the soil, 2 to 3 feet.
Okay.
Then that may take a couple hours or even 4 hours, but then once you get that soil really soaked, then you can let it go for a couple weeks without watering again, especially in the spring and the fall. Once a week at the most, and that would be during the hottest part of the year, in maybe August and September.
In September.
And then in October, you want to water once.
Okay.
A good deep soak, and then you should probably get less fruit split.
Okay.
And they should be ripening now.
It's still right now. I mean, I have lots of pumpkins, but almost every single one of them are open, and they're not being full ripe yet. They're sour. They're not.
They haven't colored up. The seeds haven't colored up for them.
Exactly.
Well, just stop watering.
Okay.
It doesn't, especially with the rain we had last week. You don't need to water again for at least 2 weeks.
Okay.
And they should actually be ripening up pretty rapidly now. But yes.
Yeah, they are ripe. Right, I have quite a few of them. They're real red, but lots of them are open and they're not in full ripe.
Just leave those on the tree.
Okay.
You may get a little bit of decay right there at the split.
Exactly.
But most of the fruit will be okay. So you can just throw away the part that spoils and save the rest. They have those white paper tissue inside that divides them all up.
Right.
So you probably won't decay the whole fruit, just a little bit of it.
Just a little bit of it, yes.
So I'd imagine you'd be able to eat most of that, even though it's split.
Yeah.
And then you may get a little bit of what we call vinegar flies right there at the split, too. Those are... Vinegar flies are a type of fruit fly. The Latin name for them is Drosophila.
Very tiny. They're very
small.
Tiny ones.
And they actually feed on yeast and mold that grows on old fruit. They're not feeding on the fruit itself. They're actually fungal feeders.
Okay.
And so just they'll be okay, but don't eat the seeds right around the split. Throw those all away.
Okay. Well, thank you very, very much, and I do enjoy your program all the time.
Oh, well, thank you very much, and thank you for calling.
Thank you.
Good luck with your garden. And our number is 1-800-339-1193. If you have a question, give us a call. We'll see if we can help you out. Now, let's go on to some of the more the characteristics that are really important when you're trying to identify mushroom growing in your garden, or if you go on mushroom foray with up in the mountains. We talked about the gill attachment next. The ring light. Let's go back to, we looked at photo number 2. Let's look at photo number 3 to talk about a vulva. And you can see here, let's bring this up full spruce. Now this is Amanita ocreata, and that is a deadly poisonous mushroom. And I want to point this out here, right here, is the edge, and this is this whole thing here is the vulva, and it's used to encompass. You can see this one's shooting up, and it is used to encompass the whole mushroom, and as it pops out of the egg, it leaves behind this vulva right here, okay? So, that's why it's so important when you collect your mushrooms. Use something to pop them out of the soil so you don't just break them off. Don't just grab that stem and pull on it. You gotta reach underneath, and I'll show you what I use. Here's my basket. You have to bring a mushroom basket when you go mushroom eating or mushroom foray. And here's my trowel, and I use this trowel to dig and pop them out of the ground so I get the whole mushroom because I don't want to break off that stem. And I'll talk a little more later about how you collect them and preserve them so you can look at them later. Because a lot of times you collect a lot of mushrooms, it takes time to identify one. all sorts of look at that. That was that vulva, or the two veils. There's the partial veil that leaves the ring, and the universal veil that leaves the vulva. If they're present, present on some mushrooms, they're absent on others. Now, the stem itself can be very characteristic. And the stem can either be central, or it can sometimes be on the side or absent. It can be hollow or firm. And in one genus, the Russell, it is very firm, but it breaks like a piece of chalk. So when you collect a mushroom, you try and observe as many of the characteristics you can. Let's take a picture, take a look at photo number 7. And that's going to be the oyster mushroom. And you can see here that these actually kind of lack a stem. There's a little bit of a stem. So sometimes in the oyster mushrooms, there's a little stem right here, but pretty much these are sessile. The oyster mushroom is one of the really easy mushrooms to identify. It is now being sold in all the markets. Not all of them. I went and looked for some this morning to share with you, but I couldn't find any. I see we have another caller, so let's go to our next caller. William, calling from San Fernando Valley. You're on the air.
Yes, hi. I'm calling about a garden, a small plot of a flower garden that's at my mother's house. I'm wondering if I started to take care of this thing about a month ago, and I took a shovel and cut some full weeds. Flowers are pretty much died. And I dug it up and level out the dirt, and I tried to plant some annuals in there, and that was about the most that I did. Watered it, and we came right back. The flowers died, the weeds lived, and I'm thinking, you know, there's probably some kind of fertilizer, something I'm supposed to be doing to kill these male flowers grow, and I need to know what kind of flowers to put in there.
Okay. Well, this is a real transition period right now. The month of October, really, the last 2 weeks of September, the month of October, is when we plant our winter annuals in Southern California for color. It's also a great time to plant perennials. So if you're interested in growing some perennial flowers, then you can grow those as well. It's a great time to plant them. It gives them about 9 months before we get hot. You can also direct seed some wildflowers, too, so you have a lot of options for you. What did you plant that died? Did you plant pansies or petunias or what? Do you remember what you planted?
No, I don't. I remember that they were annuals.
And they were in a pony pack? You got them 6 in a pack?
Right.
Okay. And they died right away?
Yeah, they did, really.
After you planted them, how often do you water them?
About once every 3 days.
Okay. My best guess is you might have had some pithian root rot, which is very common on annuals in pony packs. And it kills the plants very, very quickly. And typically what happens is even though you've watered well, the plants wilt. And then when you pick them up, they're not even attached to the soil anymore. Is that what you saw?
Yeah. Well, that much I don't know. Because they so fully died, I just plowed them under after about a month.
Okay. Well, you might have, it's a possibility. You know, one of the ways you can kind of see the action of pythium. Pythium is a water mold. It's a sister genus to Phytophthora. Both of them cause root rot. Phytophthora primarily on woody ornamentals and woody hosts, and pythium on herbaceous stuff like annuals, like petunias and pansies and stuff like that. And if once it gets a hold of it, you know, it's going to kill it, unless you treat it with a chemical.
Okay.
So what you can really do to try and control that is you can mix in a lot of gypsum into the soil. Gypsum is calcium sulfate, and high calcium levels inhibit the water molds. And then a lot of organic matter. You want to mix in about 4 inches of mulch. You put down 4 inches of mulch and you turn it into a depth of 4 inches. So you have an 8-inch mixture of mulch and soil. And then,
okay, got it.
So that's kind of your pre-plant. It'll you put a little pre-plant fertilizer, and that'll really help. Now, you want to plant this now or replant now, right?
Yes, before the spring, I was wondering what I could do to make it.
Well, one suggestion I might give you would be to seed in California poppy.
Okay,
it is a spectacular show in the spring. This is the perfect time to broadcast it. You can go get a plaque of, and what you want to do is turn the soil and put in all that organic matter and some gypsum, and then water real good and wait a week, and then you get a lot of seedlings coming up from seed,
okay,
from weeds, and then you're going to turn it again, turn those under. So what you're trying to do is germinate all the weeds that are in the soil. Because when you let them germinate and you turn them under, and then when you rake it out flat and then broadcast your California poppy seed, and then you won't have so many weeds coming up. Because one of the problems with growing wildflower seeds, like you can get a wildflower mix too, but California poppy is just so pretty in the spring, it's just knocks your socks off. Is that when it starts coming up, a lot of weed seeds comes up too, because it's already in the soil. So in order to kind of knock that down, you let it germinate and then turn it in after about a week or two. And with this warm weather, the weed seeds will come up rapidly, and then you turn it down.
Excellent.
And now that the winter color that people like to grow are pansies and snapdragons and trying to think what else is really popular. Pansies, snaps. What's the other one? Well, they're going to start coming into the nurseries now. If you go to your local nursery, they're going to start selling all the winter material.
Okay.
But I like, I'll tell you, it's really a good idea to seed in your color, your annual color, if you can. Because when you buy in your color in these pony packs, that runs the risk of introducing these soil-borne pathogens, especially Pythia and Phytophthora. So you're much better off using growing your seed. It's much cheaper. Just a pack of seed, and using a pack of seed, we'll see in quite a large area. And then once you get the California poppy to grow, it will seed itself back in.
Oh, okay, great. Question. Types of flowers that you just mentioned, just to make sure I've got it right. California poppy, and there was one or two other.
Well, what you can buy in pony packs that's coming into the nurseries right now are winter annuals that are everywhere in the United States. They grow them in the spring. In Southern California, we grow them in the winter. So, so that's pansies snapdragons and primroses. That was the other one I was trying to remember. They're real pretty. And you can get those in pony packs. Now, if you plant those, if you get pony packs and want to plant some of those, I would suggest you put in a lot of calcium sulfate, you put in a lot of mulch, that'll help, but you probably would do better if you also treat them for root rot when you plant them. And the material you want, you can either get a material called Aliette. It's spelled A-L-I-E-T-T-E. Aliette is a registered fungicide that controls root rot caused by the water moles, by Phytophthora and Pythia. And that is a white powder. You can get it at Armstrong Nursery. You can get it at some other nurseries, perhaps, but I know Armstrong carries it. It's not real cheap. It's about $25 for about 4 ounces. If you want to get the same thing in a fertilizer form, it's called Fosgard. And it's sold by JH Biotech in Ventura County. Now, that's you have got to go to their website, JH Biotech, it's BIOTECH.com, and you get the Fosgard. It comes in a variety of formulations. It comes as a 040 and a 060 and a 42515. Any of those would be fine. Probably maybe the 42515 would be good for you because that's 4% nitrogen. 25% phosphorus, in this case phosphorus acid, which actually controls the root rot. And it's very, very cheap. It's about $30 a gallon, and that gallon would last you about maybe 5 to 10 years. And that $25 packet of Aliette will last you about half a season. Because you're and you're gonna want to treat, if you plant the pansies and the snapdragons and the primroses and stuff, treat them once a month.
Okay, great. Is the Fosgard or the Aliette?
Yeah, either one. The Fosgard is much cheaper. It comes as a liquid. It's available from JH Biotech and Ventura. It's about $30 a gallon. You can get it in quarts, too. And it's, you know, especially, you know, because the water moles are very key and important pathogens in gardens and in agriculture. It's, you know, Phytophthora causes root rot in avocado and citrus and many other crops. And most of the commercial growers have stopped purchasing the registered fungicides, and they're buying these phosphorus acid fertilizers. And that's what Fosgard is. It's a phosphorus acid fertilizer.
Okay, great. I grow most of it. How do I walk? Should I sprinkle or can I just run along?
I would use a sprinkler. You need to step away from your DVO a couple of feet. That's why I don't do that. But what you want to do is a good soak once a week. And I would use a sprinkler. And you want to, you know, probably about a 30-minute soak once a week. Because when we get cool like this, as we get into the cool part of the year, then you don't have to water very often because it's just not very hot. And that would be through this month and maybe in November. If we get a good rain, a good hard rain, with about an inch or two comes down in a storm, then you might not need to water for about 2 to 4 weeks, depending on the temperature. If you get real cold, then probably you would need to water for a whole month. Okay?
So, with no rain, you said about once a week?
Well, with no rain, you're going to water at least every 2 weeks and probably once a week.
Gotcha.
Okay?
Gotcha. Thank you.
Well, thank you for watching and calling in, and good luck with your garden.
Thank you.
Okay. Let's move on and talk some more about our mushrooms. Now, there's another, we were going to look at photo number 7. Let's look at photo number 7. And, oh, we looked at this already. Okay. So you can see here that this is Picina stem. And so if the cutlet in the key were to say stem present or absent, in this case it's absent, it may say stem present or absent or lateral. But in this case it's pretty lateral. We can also look at photo number 8. Let's bring that up. And this is also the oyster mushroom, Pleurotus osteratus. And typically this grows off of dead stumps or trees. It causes a heart rot in living trees. But it also decomposes logs and things. And you can see that that's growing right off the tree behind it, the trunk behind it. And right here is the stem. And pretty much it's kind of absent in Pleurotus, although sometimes it's lateral. Now let's talk about the next thing is about staining. Many mushrooms stain, which means when you scratch them or you handle them, they'll either stain, they'll change color. And like I mentioned earlier, Agaricus epidermis, which is a fairly common agaric that we see coming in lawns throughout Southern California, when you scratch the stem or cut through the base, it stains yellow instantly. And that tells you, and there are some other species of yellow staining Agaricus, but the most common one in Southern California is Agaricus epidermis. Its epidermis means yellow staining. What do you know? What a name. But in addition, there are some boldings that also stain. They typically stain blue, and I'll show you that in photo number 14. Let's look at 14. And this is Bolinus gyophilus. Let's take a look at this Bolinus, and you can see that this has been handled. And right in here, you can see that right there on the gills, not on the gills, I'm sorry, there's a pore. This is a Bolinus after all, that it is stained blue. And you can see some blue staining right in here, too. So, now, if we had these mushrooms right here in hand, it's a little more spectacular. There's another one that I see come up in the duff under oaks. That's Bolinus crescentorum, very common in Southern California. It's the red cracked or red capped bully. I see we have another phone call, so let's go to our caller. Barry, calling from Los Angeles. You're on the air.
Hi. Thank you. I have an Asian pear tree that I planted in my backyard about 24 years ago. It has never pushed any fruit out. I have thought about possibly getting pollen in some form that I can spray
it's an Asian pear.
Yes, the kind that produce those brown pears that are fairly expensive in the supermarket rather than the ones that are the type that are pear-shaped.
Okay. Do you know the chill requirement for your pear? Does it bloom in the spring? Do you get flowers?
I should know all this, right? It blooms toward the end of summer. It should have been blooming about now, I believe.
That's really quite odd. It should bloom in the spring. Pears don't bloom.
My tree's backwards.
Yeah, your tree's doing something unusual. My first guess is you have a variety that requires more chill than you get. Where do you live?
Just south of West Hollywood.
Okay, well, the thing about pears, and you say Asian pear, sometimes I'm not sure what that exactly means. Pyrus is the pear genus, P-Y. Let me look up Pyrus, because I want to see if...
A pear that normally grow to about 3 or 4 times the size of a small apple, and they're a brown car on the outside.
Have you ever had any fruit at all?
They've gotten to the size of a green pea or maybe a swollen green pea, and then they fall off. It tends to push out fruit, but it doesn't quite ever get there.
Well, usually the most common reason a pear or an apple or one of the stone fruits would not produce fruit is that it needs a chill in the winter. And it's not getting enough chill, and it blooms poorly in the spring. And your pear should bloom in the spring.
When the tree blooms, it blooms very well. There are flowers everywhere.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah. But when it's time for the fruit to come out, it rarely happens. Only twice in the last 24 years fruits appeared, and then they only got to the size that I mentioned.
And they fell off. Well, one thing you can try, and this is done when people have to hand pollinate, is you get a little paintbrush, and you go from flower to flower to flower, and just touch it to the flower, and go touch it to the next flower, and touch it to the next flower. That's assuming that your flowers are complete flowers, and they have both the male and female parts. They have stamens, and they have pistils. And most pears are that way.
I could actually do this without buying pollen from somewhere.
Yeah, I don't know where you buy pollen. I don't think you can buy pollen. So the other thing is, if it needs a pollinator, and I'm not sure what pear you've got. You say Asian pear, and I've got to tell you, I don't know that variety. Not that, it just means I don't know it, which is one more thing out of the million things I don't know. You can try that when it blooms. The other thing is to go to the L.E. Cook website. L.E. Cook is a big grower of fruit trees, the biggest grower of fruit trees probably in the western United States. And they're up in the Central Valley. And they've got a fruit guide. And so go to their website, lecook.com.
That's L like London, E like Edward, Cook, C-O-O-K.
C-O-O-K-E, I believe. And they got, and take a look at their pears. See if they got one called Asian pear. And then read about it. Read about its chill requirement, number one. Then read if it's self-fertile or if it needs a pollinator. If it's setting some fruit and dropping it, it may be that the tree, that tends to mean that the tree itself is not healthy and can't mature its fruit. But I suspect but if it flowers really well, then it's not going to be a chilling problem, because if it doesn't get enough chill, it doesn't bloom. That's when the chill is very well. And then, so how often do you water it?
Weekly.
Once a week?
Once a week.
And when you water it, how long do you water it for?
About 10 minutes.
Oh, not long enough.
Well, also, there's an area around it where there's concrete block, and I hose that off once in a while because of our dogs.
Yeah.
So it gets water all the time, but not intentionally.
Okay. The best way to water it is to soak it deep, about every 2 to 3 weeks.
Okay.
And so you're going to want to water it. Can you, do you have a basin around it? Well, you can fill up that basin 3 or 4 times with a hose. Once a week or once every 2 weeks. At the most, once a week in August and September, the hottest part of the year. But generally speaking, about every 2 weeks, and then in the spring and the fall, like early spring when it's just starting to come out, you want to soak it real good once a month.
Okay.
And do you fertilize?
I have not.
Okay, you want to fertilize. You want to fertilize it up to 3 times a year. Spring, summer, fall. So generally your first fertilization will be early March, or even before it breaks the buds and starts to flower, or before it grows leaves. It's really unusual that it flowers at the end of the summer. I'll have to read about it more because I'm not familiar with this particular pear that would bloom at the end of the summer. That's really unusual. They almost always bloom in the spring. But
everything else in our backyard that's a tree does real well. We have with navel oranges, kumquats, and lemons that produce very well.
Okay, and especially citrus, you should be watered about every 2 or 3 weeks.
They're nonstop. They just go.
Yeah, but the best way to care for your fruit trees is to deep water them for several hours and then let them dry out for several weeks.
Okay. Kind of fertilizer?
Well, I like non-silo fertilizers like cottonseed meal and blood meal and bone meal. But the other, you know, the citrus avocado foods are okay. The only problem with those really is that the nitrogen source is soluble. So it's either calcium nitrate or ammonium sulfate. And those are water-soluble, you know, nitrogen salts. And you get a blast of nitrogen all at once. It lasts a week or two and then it'll go way down again in the soil. But if you sprinkle cottonseed meal underneath the canopy and water that in, it takes about 8 weeks for it to decompose and break down for the nitrogen to be available to the tree. So you get a very low availability of nitrogen for about 8 weeks, and then that's roughly when you reapply your next, you know, so if you do it early March, and then you do it again in about June or July, and then you do it about the end of September or October for your fall feeding. And
you're so knowledgeable. Thank you very much.
Okay, well, good luck with your garden, and thank you for calling.
Bye-bye.
So, that's unusual that a pear would bloom at the end of the summer. I'll have to read about that. You know, I'm looking here under Pyrus in the Sunset Western Garden Book, which is our textbook. And they don't have one called, they have a Japanese sand pear, a weeping willow pear. These are, let's see. Okay, fruiting pears are described under pear. They always fool me. I just want to check and see, for you know, it's, you know, fruit trees should bloom in the spring. If they're not fruiting in the spring, then usually that means something's odd. Asian pear. Now, they don't list anything called exactly Asian pear. And I think I'm the one who's confused, so I'll look into it. And hopefully I can educate myself about that. Well, let's go on about our mushrooms. We were talking about the staining. We looked at it. Of course, the most famous staining. You know what? We have a video, and I do want to go. I do want to go to the video. It's kind of a fun video on collecting mushrooms. Let's go to our first video. Some chanterelle lookalikes. Because chanterelles are usually bright yellow, foam chanterelles, the gills are around folds. These are actually a different species of mushroom, through gills. And some of the ball chanterelles will make you sick. This here is a true chanterelle. It's a brighter yellow. It's not such a dark yellow. And if you look at that, you see those kind of fold-like gills. They're not true gills, and they run down the stem. Now, chanterelles are absolutely one of the most delicious of all the edible mushrooms you can collect. I've only found it once myself. So, now you can see that she's cutting off and not hitting the base. That's because she knows what she's collecting. Now, here's, in this case, again, they're cutting off the stem. And this is a bullhead. And you can see that that's a poroid surface, and he's rubbing on it, and it's staining blue. So that's an indicator to the species he's looking for. And the reason he's cutting them off is because he wants to eat them. And a lot of times when you collect the whole mushroom and you pick it up, some of the dirt from the base of the stem spills into the gills, and then it's hard to get that dirt out. Now he's rubbing this one. This is a different species of bullhead, and it doesn't stain blue. So it's always important to rub just a little bit and see if you get any kind of a staining reaction when you're collecting wild mushrooms. And of course, take a look at the cap and notice any characteristics. In this case, there's no scales. In this case, the cap is all broken up. That is the red cracked bullhead. Now what they're showing is the hedgehog fungus. And that is a tooth fungus. And the tooth fungi are really a fascinating group. Instead of having gills or pores, they have teeth that hang down under the cap. And some of the best edibles are actually tooth fungi. And the hedgehog fungus or mushroom is an excellent edible. This next one, you know, this is actually a video from England. And they've got some other things that I'm not familiar with. Amethyst is here. I don't know this mushroom. It clearly kind of has a lilac color with gills, but it's unfortunate we lost our audio on that video because that was kind of a fun little video where someone's collecting mushrooms and discussing the characteristics and the things that tell him what he's collecting. So the other thing that's really important when you're collecting mushrooms is to know what they're growing on or in or in association with. So if it's growing in a lawn, typically, you know, these are what we call meadow mushrooms, like the Agaricus genus. And if it's growing under an oak tree, is it growing off of wood? That's a key and important characteristic for a mushroom. If it's fruiting right off a stump, directly off the wood, that really limits the number of species you're even going to look at. It's growing right off the wood. Again, something like Armillaria mellia, the Oberura fungus, grows right off of dead stumps or on infected trees, so it'll grow right off the wood. And so you're not going to find one of the Agaricus, like Agaricus bernardii, which we discussed earlier, that'll never grow off a piece of wood. The other thing, it could be growing off dung, too, off of animal droppings. And that's a whole group of fungi fruit off of dung. They're called Coprylus. I'm mispronouncing that. Now, where will we find our really interesting mushrooms? We're going to see some growing in our garden. We're going to see some coming up in the lawns. But really, if you want to go mushroom hunting, if you want to see the real variety that's out there, you need to go out into either an oak woodland or a pine forest. So if you go up into the mountains, on one of these forays with the Los Angeles Mycological Society, you know, that's where they go collect. And in the spring, they'll go up to Big Bear looking for morels and places like that. But under oaks, you can expect to find things like amanitas and bullies. That's, you know, the oaks are really excellent habitat for mushroom collecting. Now, I want to talk about the oyster mushroom again, because the oyster mushroom, it's a really fun mushroom. It's in a lot of stores now. They sell it now. It's very easy to grow at home. And if you want to grow it, you can do it a variety of ways. Let's just bring up photo number 8. And you can see this oyster mushroom behind me. And if you want to grow this, it's really fun to grow. There's a variety of ways to grow it. You can order what they call spawn, which is the fungus growing on grain. It could be grown on rice, or it could be grown on any type of grain, millet. And then once it's grown on that, then you can grow it on straw, or you can grow it on almost anything for that matter. And so you can just order the spawn from one of these companies, like Fungi Perfecti is a company that grows and sells spawn. And then you break it all up, and what you do is go get some straw, you get a bale of straw, you chop up the straw a little bit and boil it, and then you put the straw in a plastic bag, and then you take the spawn and you break it up and you sprinkle it into the bag with the straw, and you pack it down a little bit, tie it off in a knot, and poke holes in the bag with a fork, and within about 3 or 4 weeks, you'll have the oyster mushrooms growing out of those holes you poke and fruiting out of the bag. And that's a fun thing to do. You can also just buy these oyster logs or mushroom logs, and they're compressed sawdust with the fungus growing through the sawdust, and they'll fruit. They run about $20-$25 for one of those logs, and you'll get a handful of mushrooms. It's fun to do that. It's an expensive way to get the mushrooms. It's much cheaper to get the spawn and grow it that way. The other thing you could do is you could buy oyster mushroom grown on pieces of dowel, on wood dowel, and then get yourself a log and drill holes in the log and push these dowels into the log, and then it'll grow all through the log. And then you set that log on the edge of your lawn where it gets sprinkled with your lawn, and it'll fruit off that log usually twice a year for quite a few years, because once it gets a hold of the log, it'll take years for it to consume all that cellulose in there. And you'll get crops off of that every spring and probably every fall. And that's a fun way to grow it. Now let's talk a little bit more about the bullies. Some of the bullies, are the best edibles and most sought after, like Bolitis edulis, which is referred to as porcini in Italy, or the king bully. Let's take a look at some of the pictures. So you'll know 13, picture number 13 is one of our bullies. We've looked at it originally already once for the gluing. But let's bring that up. And this is a bully. A lot of the bullies are mycorrhizal, and then the others are usually saprophytic. So none of them are pathogenic. Some of them will make you sick to your stomach, so you need to be real careful in identifying bullies. There's another group. They refer to it as the bullies, but there's many different genera within the bullies. And one of them is psoilus. And psoilus are referred to as slipperjacks, and they're often covered with a thick layer of slime on the cap. And then the skin will be reticulate. I've eaten psoilus, and David Arora, in his book, Mushrooms and Mystified, compares it to eating cooked slugs. And I would say he's absolutely right. Psoilus is the slimiest, the most unpleasant mushroom I've ever eaten. It doesn't make you sick, but it's not very much fun to eat. Now, the polypore fungi are typically the conchs. And so, if we look at number 15 again, this is the artist conch. And this is a fairly common, this is the bottom of the pore surface. But if we look at number 16, this is how they appear when they're on the tree. Again, this is Ganoderma, and most likely Ganoderma apodilata. And you can see the pore surface is white on the bottom. And the top is brown. It can actually look varnished in some species. But these cause heart rot or crown rot in trees. And they fruit on the side of the tree. They're called shelf fungi. They're not edible. They're hard, very, very hard, just like wood, but they're all fungal tissue. And then if we look at number 17, we can see one of the ones that's varnished. This is Ganoderma lucidum. This one is used, ground up, and made for teas, and is one of the ones that's used in Chinese herbal medicine. I've collected it at the Lantan Botanical Gardens, growing off of trees. It also causes a crown rot, or at the base of the tree, or a heart rot inside the tree. And you can see that varnished look. And they are perennial conchs, and that every year they get another layer of growth. And so you can see that there's some faint rings in there. And you can see these rings right here. Here's a ring right here, and then here's a ring, and then here's this year's growth right here. And they're perennial, so every year they get bigger. There are some other conchs that are annual conchs, and they grow and they come out. And if we look at number, let's look at the sulfur shelf. We'll take the first look at the 18, picture 18. This is how they start out. They start out bright yellow and soft and mushy. You can actually take this and squeeze them. At this stage, it's actually edible. And then as it matures, it spreads out and becomes a woody conch. And number 19 will show what it looks like when it matures. This is rather old. At this point, they're very woody, and they're no longer edible. Now, the warning is with this, the sulfur shelf, which is, I've always known as Lotipper sulfurus, but I was reading just recently that they believe that our species in the West is Lotipper gilbertsonii. Taxonomists want to change the names of everything all the time. And if it's growing on eucalyptus, don't eat this, because people will get sick to their stomach when sulfur shelf grows on eucalyptus. Not everybody, but some people. If it's growing off of oak or carob, then it almost certainly would be quite edible. But you need to get it in the young, when it's young and soft and fleshy. As it ages, it hardens off. And this is an annual conch. And then after this matures and fully expands, that's it. It's going to start to deteriorate and fall apart. And next year, a whole new one will grow. That's a fairly common one. You can see that throughout Southern California. And it does indicate if you find that on a living tree, that you have heart rot. And the question is, how extensive is the heart rot? And that's the $64 question. Now, I'll show you another picture of sulfur shelf. This is number 21. And this was growing. Let's go full scale here. And you can see here, this is an avocado tree. And you can see that right here, that a large branch ripped and fell off the tree, right in here, and leaving this very big wound right here. And then the tree got infected by Lotipperus sulfurus. And here it is fruiting. And you see it's a polarized surface. Here's an old one. Here are the younger ones. And I took this picture, I think it was up in Azusa or Glendora, I forget where, when I was riding along. Now there are some other really fun fungi, and our time is starting to run out, so I want to just show you some more pictures. The coral fungi are a really fascinating group, and you really need to go to a pine forest or an oak woodland to find these. That's photograph number 22. This is Claveria. Let's bring that up full size. And this is a species of Claveria, and you can see where they're called coral. And number 23, this is also a coral fungus. I've seen these carpeting in the forest floor and some of the forests I go to. And some of them are edible, although most of them are pretty woody and not particularly edible, but just because of that fact. But the spores are made right on the tips, right in the tips, right there. And the base here is sterile. So this is the pore surface up here. These are really fun. Now, they're all the tooth fungi. Let's go to the tooth fungi, and we'll take a look at picture number 24, which is the hedgehog, or Hirsium ericinus. This is called hedgehog, or it has a couple other names. And you can see all these teeth hanging down, and the spores are made on the teeth. And I've collected this off of oak stumps up in Eaton Canyon. It is a prized edible, really good edible. And you can also grow this at home. You can order it as a mushroom log, and it'll fruit right off of it. Or you can inoculate it into a log with wood towels, just as you do with the oyster mushroom. There is another one that you will find occasionally, our scalpion. That's photograph number 25. Let's take a look at that. Let's bring that up full size. And you can see these teeth right in here, on the other side, right in there, all those teeth. This particular fungus is the only fungus that you'll find growing off of pine cones. And so it looks like a regular mushroom, but when you flip it over, it's got teeth. And it's our scalpia vulgare. This is one of the easiest ones to identify. I've never heard of anyone wanting to eat it because it's very, very small and fairly woody. In addition to the deep fungi and the coral fungi, we've got the puffballs and the stinkhorns. And they're really fun. Let's take a look at photograph number 29. This is a phallus. Oh, wait, I've jumped the gun. Oh, no, you've got. I'm sorry. I want 26. That was my fault. That's a puffball. Here we go, 26. Here is phallus. Happy on I. There's some question in my mind whether we really have two species of this particular stinkhorn or just one. But phallus, phallus and buticus is what I always do it as, but it's the stem has color in it, and it's happy on I. And you can see it's got this reticulate head. You can see all these lines right in here. It's reticulate. And this is all this goo in here, all around here. That is the spore mass, and it stinks, and it attracts flies. And they start as an egg, right here. Here's the egg. And then it pops up and shoots up in just a couple days. This is a saprophyte, typically growing on where a dead stump was. It likes, it's a primary decomposer, it likes wood. Has more than duff or leaves. And that's called a stinkhorn. And when people see this, they think it's a fungus from outer space. There's a funny story about collecting them on the lawns in England. At least they corrupt the maidens. You can see why it's called phalgus. Another one that I can say in rather frequently in the lab, or people call in, is Lyceris. And it's called the lantern stinkhorn. Let's take a look at photo number 20. I guess 27, here it is, yes. And you can see that this, the tips are all joined here, and sometimes they open up like this, and they make it like a lantern. This right in here is the spore mass, and it stinks. You can see a fly right there. So it stinks, and it smells like a rotten meat or some kind of rotten vegetation, and it's attracted to flies. If we look at photo number 28, this was sent in to me by a homeowner. And you can see the flies right on it. And the spore mass is gone now. Now it has a fluted stem that's white or pinkish. And the arms of it up here is pink. And these will separate and make it look like a lantern sometimes. Now we can go to photograph number 29 and look at a puffball. Now the puffballs and the stinkhorns are in the same group. They're called the gut fungi because they make their spores inside a gut like this, like here. Here's the gut. And they start out as just a big round ball like this, and then they'll typically develop a pore where the spores shoot out when you bump it. When they're very young and they're pure white, many of them are edible. And then some of them, now they can be the size of a quarter or up to the size of a basketball. And if we take a look at photograph number 30, we'll take a look at Calvatia pachyderma, which is extremely large, and this gets to the size of a basketball. Let's go to photograph number 30. Bring that up, full screen, and you can, there's nothing sitting next to it, but believe me, this is a huge puffball. And they can be anywhere from about the size of a soccer ball to a basketball, and it is edible, but you gotta get it when it's really young, and, or that. The entire zone will be black full of spores. There's another group of puffballs that are called burst stars, and that would be photograph number 31. And you can see why they're called burst stars. They have this star right here. This makes it look like a star. That's actually the outside covering of the puffball. Normally these are they come up like this, and when it gets wet, they peel back like this. Here's the pore. The spores, and this is a typical puffball here, but these are called earth stars. And when it gets wet, these things actually push the puffball up in the air a little bit. And then there's another really fun group, the bird nest fungi. And let's look at number 32. And that's this is Chrysibulum levi, 32. Back to their star. Here we go. You you see why they're called bird nests? These are very small. These are about the size of a quarter, anywhere from a dime to a quarter. And inside are these little eggs right there. These little eggs are inside there. And they typically grow on a very woody substrate, either on a wood chip, or I've seen them free right on fence posts. And each one of these little packets or eggs is actually a packet of spores. And when a raindrop comes in and splashes inside, it knocks out this little bundle of spores. They fly out. They've got a little cord on them. Many species do this sticky. And that'll stick to something. And that's how they get disseminated. So Crucibial leafy. There's also another genus called Nidula. And I'll show you that one in photograph number 33. So there's a handful of different genera and species that you can find. These are very common in Southern California. I'll look for them a little bit. But we went a little too far. That's Cantharellus. That's the true Chanterelle. Let's take a look at picture number 33. Back to 32. Let's go to 33. Vigilant. Okay. Well, I'll tell you what. We're running out of time, so I really want to show you one more picture, and that's number 37. 37 are the morels. The morels are not everything we looked at were plump fungi. Now we're looking at one of the sac fungi. And the sac fungi make their spores in sacs. So lining all these folds are these sacs. They're shaped like this. Inside are the spores. This is microscopic. And then the short spores are shot out like that. And there's millions of them there. And morels are really fun. They come in the spring. They're one of the foolproof mushrooms that are very easy to recognize. There are some false morels, but they really don't look the same at all. I can show you one last picture. False morel, if we have time, number 38. If we can show 38, that's false morel, Gyromitra. I want to mention that a lot of photographs I was able to show today from Fungi California by Mark Simons, Michael Wood, and Fred Stevens. I've got them off of Fungi California. Well, there you can see hundreds and hundreds of photographs. San Francisco, Michael. Thank you for watching. And next week we'll talk about high water garden. Important work with high water garden. Thank you for tuning in. Is that